Hi, it's Ivana here, and today I'm sharing the story of my life with you through some basic drawings. On May 12, 1984, I was born in a hospital in Belgrade, Serbia. Exactly 1 year later, on May 12, 1985, I was standing in front of the window of that same hospital with my dad eagerly waiting to meet my brother Sinisha. As he loves to say, with a mom who's an economist and a doctor dad, our parents are apparently the perfect match to plan their kids being born on the same day, exactly 1 year after the other. We moved to Jajce, Bosnia, and there, surrounded by a huge family, mountains, animals, and beautiful nature, is where I spent my childhood. My mom worked in a local electric plant, and my dad was the director of the local medical center. He's actually very famous still because he was the first doctor in the region. Unfortunately, at the beginning of the 90s, the Balkan Civil War broke out. I remember running for shelter in the basement of our building or at my grandmother's house. The building or the house would be shaking, and you could hear very loud thunder-like sounds. The war was fueled by ethnic issues, which became a huge problem for our family. My dad was Bosnian, but my mom was Serbian. And suddenly overnight, my brother and me became children of mixed blood instead of just being Yugoslavian. Fearing for our life, my parents made extremely difficult and dangerous decision to flee the country as refugees. Through massive luck, kind people, and a lot of help from the universe, we finally reached the Netherlands. We first stayed in a meditation community in a city called Zutphen, where my parents were allowed shelter, food, and education for us in return for menial jobs on the property like washing dishes and cleaning. After a while, with help from local Yugoslavian community, we moved to this small town called Lelystad. My mother had learned meditation and thought the meditation community called Sidodorp might be able to help us stay out of a refugee camp. My parents had heard incredibly terrifying stories about the camps, but as refugees, they weren't allowed to work or even rent an apartment. So the Sidodorp community stepped in and somebody rented an apartment in their name. My dad, coming from a farmer family, helped out on a local farm in order to make enough money for our groceries. My mom stayed back home to take care of my brother and me. Even though we had a super small apartment where the four of us all slept in one room, my brother and me never felt like our life changed much because my parents did everything they could to make life as normal as possible. Only recently my dad told me that actually plenty of times my parents went hungry because there wasn't enough food for all of us. After many years of refugee interviews and a lot of legal processes, our family was officially allowed to stay in the Netherlands. Immediately we moved into a typical Dutch family home called Rijtjeshuis. I thought we had become super rich because for the first time in my life, at 10 years old, I had my own room. What I didn't anticipate, however, was both my parents getting back to work and suddenly being alone at home all the time. Growing up in a huge family and even being sheltered during the refugee years by a small home, I wasn't used to being alone so much. I didn't click with Dutch kids because of many culture shocks. In the Netherlands, for instance, it's normal to send people home right before dinner, unless you're specifically invited. As a child, I of course didn't understand the concept of cultural differences, and I mostly just felt rejected. Luckily, in school, I met Nadine, who is of Surinamese Hindustan descent. Nadine decided to adopt me, and that day, I gained a sister for life. Nadine's parents never sent me home when I was playing there until late. I was very happy about that because her mom, Nadia, is still the best cook I know. I didn't know it back then, but Nadine truly is one of the biggest blessings of my life. She always invited me to go and play, and when the following disaster happened, she stood by me like a real sister. At age 11, I decided to switch primary schools because Nadine was leaving for high school and our other best friend also left Amadushi Primary School, where we all used to be in the same class. In that new primary school, just a few months before leaving for high school, I got into a huge fight with the whole class. The fight was my fault, to be honest, because I had gossiped a lot. Rightfully so, all the other kids were mad at me. For months, I got bullied, and very often a group of kids would threaten to beat me up. But whenever Nadine would hear anybody threatening me, she'd come immediately after high school and nobody dared to touch me. Despite never getting beaten up, this episode did give me extremely deep scars and changed me. I learned to never say anything about anybody that I wouldn't repeat to their face. But I also became very aggressive as I had decided that this was the last time somebody would bully me. So when I left for high school called Drietlanden, I developed a very big mouth. I never wanted to bully another kid because I knew how painful that was. But I absolutely tortured my teachers by making fun of them, always talking back and openly defying them. It was my protection against being bullied by kids, but to be honest, I was also extremely bored. I loved learning and my grades were always top of the class. I just found high school not challenging at all, so I got into trouble to at least have some entertainment. Every year, in about the final months before summer holidays, my principal would reach her limits with me and threaten to expel me. That's when I'd calm down until a new year started and I'd play my games all over again. My parents were too busy to scold me too much, and I'd actually also turned against them. We fought a lot because by now I really felt abandoned being home alone so much. With my cool friends, I also discovered drinking and parties during high school. I even tried smoking weed twice. However, when Nadine found out, she was not amused. She always supported me, but when she heard I had smoked weed, she, like a true big sister, told me how insanely disappointed she was in me. I never smoked a joint after that again. Like I said, in many ways, she's one of my biggest blessings in life because she always inspires me to do the right thing. Our high school was the worst in the city, with many kids sometimes even drinking and smoking weed during school hours. I saw firsthand how some extremely bright kids turned into stoned out zombies and even turned to a life of crime. That high school was absolutely the best warning I could have gotten in life on how not to ruin your future. For 6 long years, I bided my time there until I finally got to go to college. I decided to study law at the University of Amsterdam because I'd seen how law had determined how and why our family received refugee status. Law, in my eyes, was a life skill that would be beneficial in any career path I'd choose after. And I was right, but I'll get back to that a bit later on. Starting college, for the first time in my life, I felt like I could breathe. Getting a lot of freedom on when and how to study, I stopped bullying my teachers. For the first time, I also respected them because they had so much knowledge, which was not only derived from parenting basic books. This is also the time when I moved out of my parents' home. I already was earning my own money since 15 years old. Fun fact, my first job was cleaning offices, but I got too bored and quickly moved on to become a salesperson in clothing and shoe shops. With the money I earned, I could afford to get a small apartment 2 blocks away from my parents, which gave me even more peace in life. I fought less with them because we now all had our own space. The coolest thing was that Nadine moved out too, in the apartment opposite of me. We would party so much in Amsterdam during those times. It was really a great time in life. During one of those party nights, I met the first love of my life. Let's call him S1. He was tall, super smart, and extremely funny. On top of that, we had the same background as he also was a Balkan refugee. S1 moved in with me in less than 3 months because we both were convinced that we had found a person who we'd grow old with. Unfortunately, we were really too young and immature for this kind of serious commitment. An example of our immaturity was when I dreamed of studying a year abroad, but S1 told me we'd have to break up as he didn't sign up for a long-distance relationship. In my innocent belief that this was the person I'd grow old with, I decided to not go for my dream. I compromised with him by both agreeing to move abroad when we would turn 30 years old. This compromise is still one of the biggest regrets of my life, but also one of the biggest life lessons I would soon learn. Upon finishing my law bachelor, next to taking up my law master, I decided to take on a communications master too, with a focus on public relations. The one thing I despised most during my law bachelor were my fellow students. Law students really love to argue about nonsense for the sake of arguing, but on top of that, a lot of them are so insanely arrogant, coming from rich families. Starting communications, I finally met fun, social people who I loved spending time with. I finished both masters within 5 years and had only ever failed one exam. If you know the statistics program SPSS, I sincerely hope you don't have the trauma that I still have while trying to master it. I think it speaks for itself that by this time I had turned my love for learning into a hardcore, super ambitious, overachiever personality. S1 completely matched me in this. We were the power couple who both wanted the best in life. So when I started applying for jobs, he did everything he could to help me get a job at Hill & Knowlton Strategies, one of the best communications firms in the world. After passing an extensive selection round against 10 other people, Claudia and me were the chosen ones for that year's trainee selection. I felt on top of the world. On our first day at work, Claudia and me took less than 30 seconds to decide that we would be ultimate allies. And we would really need each other because corporate working life turned out to be nothing like school. We got the absolute privilege to learn communications and public relations from some of the best professionals the Netherlands has to offer. Also, we immediately got to work for some of the best brands in the world. Just like with law, I felt like I was learning a life skill more than just working on a career. However, it didn't have a happy ending at all. The price Claudia and me both paid for working at this top level was our health and our relationships. S1 and me were fighting constantly because I was absolutely exhausted. We almost broke up that first year of me working. S1 proposed to buy an apartment in Amsterdam as living closer to both our jobs should give both of us some peace. Even though it felt like a bit too much responsibility for me at 25 years old, we bought an extremely beautiful new apartment in one of the most upcoming neighborhoods in Amsterdam. Through work, I also had the privilege to meet another absolutely beautiful human, Masha. Masha is one of the OG beauty bloggers in the Netherlands. I was a huge fan. Work made us cross paths in person. After meeting just twice, we became best friends. Masha would also turn out to be way more than just my beauty hero. One night during a girls' trip in Hong Kong, for the first time ever, I confessed to her I really disliked my corporate job. Her, being a self-made entrepreneur boss lady, spent the next few hours brainstorming business ideas with me. She believed in me and that changed my perspective on life. After that trip, I started my own fashion blog for women in the corporate world. Every day I'd write a blog of at least 600 up to 1,000 plus words. S1 even decided to start his own blog because of me. He had had his own company before but sold that shortly after he met me. He hated his own current corporate job too, but we had taken on a hefty mortgage together, so he couldn't just quit like that. He asked me if I'd be willing to back him by staying in my corporate job. If he'd fail in his new company, I'd still be able to cover our mortgage. I was happy to support him while working on my own company in my spare time. Very often we'd sit opposite of each other at our dining table and work on our future companies. Too bad that that actually turned out to be the reason we'd never speak to each other again. After having lived for exactly 1 year in our dream apartment, we ended our relationship. Initially, we tried to be friends, but when S1's company took off swiftly and mine was lagging, he refused to support me like I had once supported him. I couldn't accept that and ended all communication. I felt like a loser that I couldn't make my company work and shut down my corporate fashion blog. Just like not going to study abroad because of a relationship, I still regret giving up something that gave me so much joy because of inexperience. But luckily, life decided to bless me with a more supportive life partner who I still hold responsible for living my current dream life. Quickly moving on from my breakup with S1, I met the second love of my life, S2. He was an absolute unicorn and brought out the most happy, calm, joyful side of me. Also, when I was terrified but really wanted to make YouTube videos, he was the one who helped me gain enough confidence. I was so insecure about making videos that I actually filmed and edited 10 videos before finally making my first video public. On 8 December 2013, I finally decided to give it a go and press publish for the first time on YouTube. Intuitively, I knew my life would never be the same. The same realization came to me when Claudia, my awesome partner in crime at work, called me into our boring corporate kitchen to announce she was going to travel the world for a year. You can do that? I almost screamed at her from excitement. It's crazy, I know, but it has always been my dream and I started saving for it since we started working here, she told me. In that instant, my future was clear. Make YouTube videos, save enough money to travel the world, and build a business in the process. I spent the next 3 years doing just that. Every week I'd make one YouTube video. Every month I'd save a significant portion of my salary for my world trip. Every year I was a step closer to living my dream life. Little did I expect that on June 21st, 2014, when the last paycheck I needed to complete my savings goal hit my bank account, I wasn't even able to get out of bed. Due to an extreme work schedule for months on end, I was so severely exhausted that I had a of physical and mental burnout. I could barely read. Writing an email did not just feel like asking me to lift 500 kg, but also made me cry uncontrollably. My doctor sent me home to recover for at least 6 months. Imagine having all the money you need to fulfill your dream after saving for it for years, but the only thing being able to do is sleep for at least 12 hours a day. This was another event that changed me for life. I promised myself to never betray my heart, intuition, and body like that again. Eventually, abiding this principle would even lead me to move to India, but first, I got to travel. My solo world trip started with a first flight to Bali on January 26, 2015. Many flights would follow after that. I traveled most of Asia, being in absolute awe of my new life. It was everything I had ever dreamed of and so much more. And so was India, which was the last stop of that first year of travel. It was the country I was most terrified of visiting due to the horrendous news stories we all hear too often. But it was also the country I had waited to visit since I first saw the gorgeous Bollywood movie Devdas when I was only 15 years old. So, as my plane shakily landed in Kochi on September 25th, 2015, I was also shaking with fear and excitement equally. What I found in India, however, was nothing less than magic. Coming out of the plane, everything went so smooth, people were so insanely kind, and I was stunned how the scent of warm, spicy air gave me an instant sense of home. By coincidence, I stumbled into a yoga class that week in Kochi. The peace I experienced made me stay for a yoga teacher training for a month longer. I have never been the same after that. My intuition became so strong and my connection with India so deep. Very often, I'd feel Mother India guiding me from within. Even when I left yoga teacher training, I just constantly felt taken care of. This reached a climax when I arrived in Mumbai for the first time. Instantly, I knew this is my future home. And I rarely get into details about this because I'm absolutely aware how wannabe hipster enlightenment it sounds, but I was never that person who doesn't think rationally. So I went back to the Netherlands. Estu, who I loved beyond what words could describe, was never the adventurous type. So we tried to make it work by me becoming a travel vlogger. I travel every single week all across the world. It was my dream job because at one point I started getting paid to travel and make YouTube videos. However, every time upon returning to the Netherlands, I was unhappy. The cold, rainy weather had always bothered me. Cycling through the rain and wind to high school as a teenager, I'd always promised myself to move to a tropical country when I was old enough. Returning to the Netherlands for my second trip to India in 2016, the cold weather really hit me hard. I barely left home for a month. It was then when I realized I can't live here anymore. I need to be able to freely go outside without wearing 10 layers of clothes. I don't want to constantly crave taking a flight to a tropical country whenever I'm at home. This realization was really tough because besides the climate, my life in the Netherlands was pretty much perfect. On 11 July 2017, I left the Netherlands for good on a flight to India with only 3 bags and a heart that told me this was the right thing to do. Despite the decision being right, those first 6 months of leaving home were absolute heartbreak. Heartbreak of losing my relationship, my home, and my friends. It was also an extremely uncertain time because I didn't know exactly how I was going to earn enough money to sustain myself. The moment I moved, my Dutch clients dropped off too. Luckily, my nearest and dearest always supported me. After 3 months of travel in India, I couldn't stand to be alone anymore. Panic attacks would come when I'd lose Wi-Fi or mobile connection, so I left to Hong Kong and stayed with my brother for the rest of the year. In January 2018, I felt healed and strong enough to try again. However, coming to Bangalore, I was still scared to be alone. An Indian flatmate seemed the wisest decision. This is how I met Nishtha, and she was nothing less than the angel I needed that first year living in India. She taught me how to cook Indian food, how to deal with bureaucracy, dance some Bollywood songs, but also how to properly wear Indian ethnic wear. I fell in love again and slowly started making new friends. Building a new life in a new country is beyond difficult, is what I learned. My legal education and communication skills were absolutely the life skills that I needed to survive. But after all this, I can firmly say I'm really happy with my daily life in India. I love the weather in Bangalore, the park, parks, the hipster culture, and even a simple thing like getting to have proper chai every single day. It has been a long journey to have the life of my dreams. A lot of sacrifices were made because nothing comes without a price. But what I learned, and I also hope you get through listening to my life story, is that if you believe you deserve to live your dream life and are not afraid to take risks, life will support you. Hope you enjoyed getting to know me a bit better. If you'd like to see more of my videos, make sure to subscribe and make sure to put a thumbs up. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully I'll see you next time.